How much would you pay to fish alongside bassing greats like Denny Brower, Roland Martin, and a host of others? Well, now you can. Call us toll-free and learn from the pros by becoming a BASS member. Here's how.
In addition to 10 big issues of Bassmaster magazine and full membership credentials, you get a free tackle pack, including auger tail worms, true turn hooks, strand line, spinner bait, and the free book, Jackpot Bassin.
To join, call 1-800-441-2626. Send no money. We'll gladly bill you.
If you've ever thought of starting a business, or if you already have, the Wall Street Journal could open some new doors for you. And more important, help keep them open.
Call 800-336-1111 for this special introductory offer. 13 weeks for just $29.75 with a money-back guarantee. 13 weeks, $29.75. Phone 800-336-1111 now for the Wall Street Journal.
All the action and excitement from New England Raceways is coming your way each week on Raceweek. Raceweek, the video magazine that brings you closer than ever before to the fascinating world of the Super Modified, the Dirt Modified, and much, much more. Now, you can be a part of all the thrills and spills from New England's racing scene. Raceweek, coming your way each week on the New England Sports Network. Don't miss it.
The Indoor Midget Racing Series continued this past weekend, pitting youth against experience. Sounds like Tyson Holmes. Here's Dee Downs to tell us more.
The Midget Tour stopped this past weekend in Tulsa, Oklahoma for the running of the second annual Chili Bowl race. With $4,000 going to the first place finisher, the series' best drivers showed up in hopes of being able to make a hefty deposit in the bank Monday morning. In Friday night's racing action, Mel Kenyon keeps up his streak of hard knocks, getting sandwiched by John Backlund in the number 92 machine. Number 80, Jack Burke, gets the Airborne Award for the weekend as he gets tangled up going into turn one and does a somersault even Kathy Rigsby would be proud of, although he needs to work on his landing. On to the night's main event. Sammy Swindell's luck runs out when he tries to cut the corner on turn one and gets chewed up and spit out of contention. Number 55, Danny Fry, stayed out front and out of trouble to bring it by the checkered flag first. The start of Saturday's main event saw 1987 midget champion Kevin Olsen on the pole, but he would give up the top spot on the first lap to number 55, Danny Fry. Tom Eatwell and Dave Strickland slow down the pace with this spin on the backstretch. Back to speed, number 55, Danny Fry, is still the leader, but 24-year-old Scotty Hatton on the number 17 car begins to make his way through the pack. Hatton, who runs his racing effort on a tight budget, was using second-hand tires, but it didn't seem to matter as he took the lead away from Fry halfway through the 40-lap event. Number 92, John Backlund, brings out a late caution with this spin on the backstretch. The yellow flags posed little problem for Hatton as he was able to hold off the field and hold on to the lead. Hatton picked up the $4,000 first-place prize. Danny Fry had to settle for second.
Yellow flags, I don't know. They can help you and they can hurt you. And today they helped me at the right times because I got into some lap traffic early. And you never know what those guys in the back are going to do because a lot of times they're not working very good and they're all over the place. You don't know where they're going. And I felt that when they did come out, I was going, oh, thank you, because I knew I had a clean shot then.
I'm Dee Downs reporting for This Week in Motorsports.
Well, that's it for This Week in Motorsports. Thanks for watching. If we don't see you at the track, we'll see you next week right here. Until then, I'm Pat Scanlon. So long, everybody. This Week in Motorsports has been brought to you by the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company. Never matters how far you go, Goodyear takes you home. And by Ford and your local Ford dealer. We invite you to test drive the 1988 Ford cars and trucks. Have you driven a Ford lately?
Introducing MiniVac, the amazing miniature cleaning system designed to take on hundreds of chores no ordinary tools can handle. MiniVac cleans away dust from camera lenses, computer keyboards, figurines, or stereo equipment. MiniVac's powerful motor vacuums away dust and dirt. It comes with two wand attachments, two ultra-soft brush nozzles, and a reusable vacuum bag. Keep one in the car for cleaning along the dash, steering column, stereo, ashtrays, and seats. MiniVac is perfect for removing dust and debris from pictures, models, and those impossible-to-reach crevices. In this special television offer, you get MiniVac with all five attachments, plus convenient storage case for only $19.95. Here's how to order.
Credit card and COD customers call toll-free 1-800-453-6800 or save COD fees by sending $19.95 plus $3 shipping and handling to MiniVac P.O. Box 3170-J, Ogden, Utah, or call 1-800-453-6800.
Begin the new year with live Hockey East action. BC and Bates Northeastern, Friday, January 8th at 7 p.m.
Coming up on Race Week, a look back at 1987 at the Stafford Motor Speedway, where the SK Modifieds were the premier division of excitement for the competition there, plus the best in late model street stock competition at the premier half-mile race facility, and a look at New England's largest indoor all-automotive flea market, Auto Parts Swap and Sell.
This is winter at its best here in the heart of New England. Over a foot of snow has fallen here in New England, and this is what New England is all about in the winter months. We only have memories of what it was about during the summer months when it was sunny, hot, and humid, and the excitement of auto racing warmed our blood. That excitement is what we're about to show you once again here on Race Week. Hello, I'm Ben Dodge, and I welcome you to another edition of Race Week. I'm standing here in West Springfield, Massachusetts, in front of the Better Living Center building on the Eastern States Fairground. Auto Parts Swap and Sell, New England's largest indoor all-automotive flea market, is behind us. 350 vendors from 27 states are assembled inside, and literally thousands and thousands of people are starting to come in. They're looking for parts and accessories, perhaps the hot setup for their race car, their street car, or that special interest automobile. This event has kind of been something special to get everybody together during the off-season. But speaking of the off-season, now we're going to go back and take a look at last year's season. Talk about taking chances and gambles, that's what a good promotion is all about. The Stafford Motor Speedway took that kind of a chance in 1987. The SK Modifieds were the premier division, and the excitement for them proved to be highly competitive. The management of Stafford combined the SKs with the late model streets. And in the marketplace, they took a great deal of criticism in reference to that. But still, it all worked out well, and the SK Modifieds really put on a great show. We'll go back and relive 1987 at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Take a look at SK Modified racing at its absolute best, and take a look at the late model streets, too. But first, before we do all of that, we want to remind you that in addition to that, on this edition of Race Week, we'll also be taking a look at Auto Parts Swap and Sell. And we certainly hope that you'll be a part of this edition as we go now and take a look at SK Modified racing at the premier half-mile race facility, the Stafford Motor Speedway.
The first event at the Stafford Motor Speedway for the SKs for 1987 was the Spring Sizzler. They were ready and ready to do battle once again. The green flags would come out and the start of the 1987 season would begin. Ricky Fuller would work his way to the inside when trouble would develop and Wayne Dion would drop off the pace with car number 66. Ted Christopher would quickly work his way to the front of the field as Richie Gallup would look strong with the number X6, quickly moving into position number 2. Jeff Fuller puts the Variety Auto Sales number 16 to the inside, suddenly gets crossed up, comes across the track and tags the wall down the front straightaway. A mix-up occurs, bringing a caution. Rick Fuller is pressured heavily by Ted Christopher. Kerry Malone quickly goes to the outside and Bo Gunning comes to life. All of a sudden, Ricky Fuller is out of the event with car number 25. And Teddy Christopher has a problem. Smoke erupts from beneath the hood of the automobile, but he is able to rejoin the competition here. Gallup is on the outside and dialed in. Christopher down low. Evenly matched, they run lap after lap. Teddy Christopher still smoking. He will maintain position number one and secure the victory as the checkered flag will wave to start the 1987 season. By the middle of June, the competition proved to be highly competitive in the SK Modified. Brad Thrall would lead this event when suddenly Buck Ackley would go spinning with car number 71. Kerry Malone would also be involved in the mix-up, and so win car number 13 for Teddy Christopher. Christopher would make heavy contact with the wall. Back towards the front of the field, a new battle was developing. Suddenly another spin would occur on the racetrack. Sonny O'Sullivan would be involved in this mix-up, so would Marcel Littrell with car number 6. Mike Christopher was coming on like gangbusters. He would dial in down low when suddenly he would lose some suspension parts and go spinning by himself. Mike Christopher would now be out of the event, but car number 66, Ricky Fuller, would hold on to secure a victory at the Stafford Motor Speedway. More great competition continued during the month of July in the SK Modified. Leading the field off the turn, a new challenge was developing. Ted Christopher was coming quickly to the front in hot pursuit of John Anderson. In a turn number one, Ricky Summers gets a tap and he goes spinning with car number 59. Summers spins across the racetrack to bring out yet another caution. When the field goes back to green off turn number four, Jeff Berry gets out of shape. Wendell Kilcullen squeaks by with car number 84. Berry goes sliding to the center of the infield and Marcel Littrell gets out of shape. Sonny O'Sullivan makes it by a massive mix-up. Ed Plinke Jr. is involved here. But Sonny O'Sullivan is in command of the event. He will hold on to secure his first win of 1987. Twin 50-lap feature events would be the story at the Stafford Motor Speedway next for the SK Modifieds. And once again, it would be a night to remember. Post-competition would be the setting for this in the best in open-wheel competition. Christopher would lead the event when Ron Rocco would start to dial in and reel him in. It would be a battle of the 13s as Rocco was putting on some heavy pressure. Suddenly, Jerry Pearl would go spinning in the S&S race cars, number 33. Pearl would regroup and rejoin the field and pick up from the back of the field, but the checkered flag would wave and Ted Christopher would secure the win. Round number two, and the competition proved to be highly competitive once again as the SK Modifieds were set to go the distance. Close competition saw car number 7 go spinning. Richie Gallup involved and Sonny O'Sullivan. Larry Ross would also be involved in the mix-up here. John Anderson was coming on strong as Bob Potter would move to the outside with car number 52. Brad Thrall would almost stop at the racetrack. Bo Gunning would be involved in the mix-up here, and so would Rick Summers with car number 59. Wendell Kilcullen Jr. heads back to the pits. Back towards the front of the field, more great close competition here as the battle is on. Ricky Fuller leads the pack, and down to the line, he will secure the win. Modified Madness was up next for the SK Modifieds, and it too would be a night of madness and a night of excitement. Ricky Summers was quickly working his way to contend at the front of the field when Bo Gunning would go down low and take over position number one. Trouble would develop off the turn. Ed Flemke Jr. would have a problem with his suspension. A car would go spinning to the inside. Flemke would be heading down pit road. Bo Gunning, Kerry Malone battling right up front when sparks would fly towards the middle of the pack. Richie Gallup was coming on strong to the outside. Challenge was on. Gallup was coming to the front. But Gunning would hold on and pick up yet another impressive victory. In rows of two, the field would come to close once again. Late in the month of July, the field was starting to get strung out impressively. Leading the field off the turn would be car number 10 for Ed Plenke Jr., when all of a sudden, Kerry Malone would get out of shape and go sliding towards the center of the infield with car number 79. Ricky Fuller would hold off the challenges of Sonny O'Sullivan. Bo Gunning was patiently waiting in the wings, and so wasn't Ted Christopher. But Ricky Fuller would be the man that would secure yet another victory in the Privilege Auto Sales number 66. Gary Leach would quickly jump into position number one with car number 34. Ed Plunkey Jr. would challenge impressively on the outside. When Richie Gallup would try to move in, tap the back bumper of Leach, and Leach would go spinning. Towards the front of the field, Sonny O'Sullivan was getting dialed in. Mike Christopher down low. Jerry Pearl, when all of a sudden, Ricky Fuller would make contact with Pearl. John Anderson would be involved, and so wouldn't Kerry Malone. Richie Gallup would head suddenly back towards the pit area. This time, Ed Plenty Jr. and Bo Gunning would come together, but Ronnie Rocco would secure the win with car number 13. Starting the month of August, there was more close racing action from the SK Modifieds at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Deep into the turn, the action proved to be highly competitive as Ed Plunkey Jr. would get dialed in on the outside. Jimmy Broderick could have a problem and drop off the pace rather suddenly. Down the back straightaway, a new battle was on. Kerry Malone would suddenly drift up a bit. Leach would be involved in yet another mix-up. Bo Gunning would go sliding towards the center of the infield. Ron Rocco was now in command, and Ricky Fuller was right there to contend with him. Spires would meet with his fortune and tag the wall. Buck Ackley would be involved here as Jerry Frew would come back to contend with car number 33. But Ed Plunkey Jr. from Southington, Connecticut would secure a victory at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Wendell Kilcullen Jr. would be starting in on the outside of row number one in this event. He would quickly try to contend when suddenly a mix-up would occur off turn number four. Ricky Summers would go spinning with car number 59. Jerry Pearl was looking impressive when Richie Gallup would go sliding through the center of the infield with the number X6 automobile. Back towards the front of the field, Kerry Malone is looking strong, but Jerry Pearl is dialed in down low. Jerry Pearl will hold on and pick up a victory in the SK Modifieds. Another exciting round of competition saw this occur in the SK Modifieds at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Leading the field was car number 61, when all of a sudden, Ricky Fuller drops off the pace with car 66. Down towards the line, it is now Richie Gallup in command of the event, when Bo Gunning literally rides over the back end of Kerry Malone's machine all the way down the front straightaway at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Back towards the front of the field, Christopher moves in and challenges Ricky Gallup. The two make contact in the turn. They will go spinning. The leader of the pack and the second place automobile are involved in the mix-up, and both are not too pleased with the outcome here. It is Jerry Pearl that will hold on and consistently pays off for Pearl, who secures the win. More great racing action from the SK Modifieds during the month of September at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Middle of the pack sees Jerry Pearl coming towards the front, looking for a championship shot. Trouble now develops. As Bupre gets involved in a mix-up, he comes back across the track and slams the wall in turn number one. Bupre is out of the event, and now Ricky Summers drops off the pace with car number 59. Off the turn and down to the line, Malone is moving in. Gallup is in command. Sonny O'Sullivan waits in the wings, and so does Mike Christopher and Ronnie Rocco. The Mighty Five will battle to get to the front of the field, but the victory will go to Richie Gallup. Ted Christopher looks so impressive, holding off the challenges of Marcel Letuel, as Christopher is the man to take down the title and secure a victory here at the Stafford Motor Speedway. SK Modified still up next, with more great racing action expected. Sonny O'Sullivan coming through the front from the middle of the pack as Alan Rosanas leads him with car number 17 for a short while. Rodonis drops off the pace. The 17 goes out wide. A mix-up occurs in turn number one. Wendell Kilcullen Jr. hits the wall hard. Dan Bupre goes to the outside. Broderick tries to keep it nice and low. Another mix-up occurred. This time involved is Alan Rodonis. Flames erupt from beneath the automobile. He is out of harm's way. Car number 17 is out of the event. Jerry Pearl is also involved in the mix-up. He will lose the title at this point. Bob Potter challenges Jimmy Broderick for position number one. Potter is still the man that is in command of the event. Kerry Malone dives down low underneath Jimmy Broderick and tries to take over position number two. But Bob Potter will hold on for the victory.
Well, we hope that you've enjoyed a look at the exciting SK Modified division. Remember, at Stafford Motor Speedway, they are the stars of the show for the 1988 year. Coming up next, we'll take a look at late model competition at the premier half-mile facility. But right now, we'll take a commercial break, and we'll be back with more of the best in New England auto racing right here with us on Race Week.
Coming at you, the World Series of Asphalt Stock Car Racing, Daytona Speed Weeks 1988, New Smyrna Speedway, February 5th through 13th. Nine exciting nights of competition. It's the fastest, most exciting half-mile race facility in the country, offering the best in several different divisions of competition. The real excitement of NASCAR-type modifieds with the top New England drivers, plus mini modifieds, limited late models, and much, much more. Plus ASA All-Pro drivers, Midwest versus the South, New Smyrna Speedway, February 5th through 13th.
He gives it to Middleton, he scores!
The sports action really heats up on NESN this weekend. Hockey East live on Friday, Minnesota, Duluth, and Lowell at 7 o'clock. Then travel to Boston Garden Saturday, the Bruins and Buffalo at 1:15. At 4:30, New England College Basketball, Niagara Northeastern. At 7:30, the Southeastern Conference, as Auburn hosts Mississippi State, followed by a Big East doubleheader, Georgetown, B.C. at 9:30, UConn, Syracuse at 11:30. Sunday at 7, the Tucker Anthony Golf Classic. And at 8, CAA action, George Mason, Richmond. You can't lose with sports on NESN this weekend. Friday, Hockey East live at 7, Minnesota, Duluth, and Lowell. The Bruins face off against Buffalo live Saturday at 1:15. New England College Basketball, Niagara Northeastern live at 4:30. Southeastern Conference Basketball, 7:30. Mississippi State Auburn, Big East at 9:30. Georgetown, B.C. and UConn Syracuse at 11:30. Sunday, Tucker Anthony Golf at 7 and CAA Basketball at 8. George Mason in Richmond. Sports on NESN this weekend, you can't miss.
This season, NESN delivers more than 80 college basketball games. The Big East, the Southeast Conference, ECAC North Atlantic, and the Colonial Athletic Conference. When it comes to college basketball, NESN delivers.
Welcome back to Race Week. You know, next we're going to be taking a look at the excitement for the late model streets at the half-mile race facility in Stafford Springs, Connecticut. But before we do that, we want to remind you that the management of the Stafford Motor Speedway has a brand new color brochure. It's absolutely free. All you have to do is drop them a line. Inside the brochure, it's got the history of the Stafford Motor Speedway, plus a look at what's in store for 1988. The SK modifies the late model streets and a whole lot more. Coming up at the premier half-mile race facility. Let's go now and take a look at late model street stock racing at its best at the Stafford Motor Speedway.
Late model street stocks have always been the fans' favorite at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Right down at the start of the 1987 season, the racing action proved to be highly competitive. Tony Sylvester was dialed in on the outside with car number 38. George Brayton gets a little bit out of shape with car number 21. Brayton goes around, he corrects the automobile, and the field will scramble for position here. Chuck Dougherty dives down low underneath Phil Rondo in turn number one. Cody gets out of shape with car number 90. Chris Konopka comes in and makes contact with car number 99. But Tony Sylvester holds off the challenges. We're in the final laps of competition. Tony Sylvester is out in front. The Tiger Lee Construction, number 38, will set the pace. Chuck Dougherty is moving in. The final lap decides the winner in this event, and Tony Sylvester will hold on and secure the victory with car number 38. More great racing action was expected out of the street stocks, and the month of June had exactly that. In a turn number one, they'd be three and four wide in the competition here. Leo Adams would work his way to the front. Now Norm Plantier comes on strong with car number 14. Plantier goes three wide in a turn number one. Car number 66, Cliff Stakey, moves to the bottom side of the racetrack and picks up a spot. But it is Rick Shawn to secure the win with car number 8X. Middle of the pack, the story is told here. In this, the late model streets during the month of July. Towards the front of the field, Danny LaVoy is coming on strong with car number 6. Middle of the pack, Rondo looks good. Rick Shawn goes to the outside, and Norm Plantier is looking good on the bottom side of the racetrack. Rondo dials in down low, and Rondo picks up a spot. Plantier goes sliding to the center of the infield. He will regroup and move towards the front of the field. Chuck Zantarski and Rick Shawn is involved in this one, as Tony Sylvester is now back in command of the event. Jimmy Ward puts the boot in Sons number 22 towards the front, but Tony Sylvester will pick up yet another victory at the Stafford Motor Speedway. By July, things were starting to settle down just a bit in the late model streets, and out in the front of the field was car number 79 for Chuck Dougherty. Phil Rondo was reeling him in, staying glued to the back bumper of the automobile. As Chuck Zantarski was moving in, it would be Chuck Dougherty to visit the winner's circle. John Guy Poulin would lead the field in a turn number one, and this the month of July at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Cliff Stakey was already starting to reel him in, and Norm Plantier was looking impressive on the inside. Butler would go down low on Phil Rondo with car number 19. Rondo and Butler would be able to regroup and head back towards the front of the field, when suddenly Rondo would go spinning in front of Leo Adams. Back towards the front of the field, it was now Chuck Dougherty being pressured heavily by Norm Plantier. Plantier would go to the outside. Cliff Stakey would go spinning. Phil Rondo down low. Rondo in command of the event. Rich Wood was coming on strong with car number 6. But Phil Rondo would set in the winner's circle. Poulin leads the field off turn number 4. Rick Dyke moves in to try to contend as Cliff Stakey sets in position number 3. Norm Plantier starts to break away from the pack, and he will move into the 4th spot. Off the 4th turn, it is Cliff Stakey in command of the event. Norm Plantier out in front. Wade Gagner goes spinning with car number 7. He goes to the outside, and the field will scramble for position here. Off the turn, it is now Chuck Dougherty back to take over position number 1. Norm Plantier battles with Phil Rondo in his quest to get back to the front of the field. But Chuck Dougherty leads the field off the 4th turn and down to the line. Dougherty secures a victory at the Stafford Motor Speedway. This time, it is Herb Bennett Jr. from Stafford Springs, Connecticut, to set the pace with car number 16. He's in a turn number 1. Chuck Zantarski tries to go low. He will try to take over position number 1. Norm Plantier and Cliff Stakey swap a little bit of paint as Phil Rondo dials in on the inside. Zantarski out in front. Chuck Dougherty makes a move down underneath Stakey. Rick Shawn goes to the outside. Wade Gagner waits in the wings. It is Phil Rondo and Chuck Zantarski to hold on and ride a challenge towards the front. But Norm Plantier will take down yet another victory at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Butler works his way to the inside initially at the start of Rick Guile as they head into turn number one. It is Butler to lead for a short time when suddenly Chuck Dougherty takes over the lead. Dougherty holds on and picks up another win at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Tom Fox and Bob Bedore lead him into turn number one. Dougherty's in the middle of the pack along with Cliff Stanky, and they'll try to get back towards the front of the field. Off the turn, Wade Gagner dialed in. He moves to the inside. Rick Shawn is on the outside, battling lap after lap. Shawn maintains position number one, and he will secure yet another victory at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Another exciting round of late model competition at the Stafford Motor Speedway proved to be highly competitive in the month of September. A massive mix-up saw Art Caruso and Bob Peer. Could think he would go to the outside, come back across, and make contact with Chris Wood. Chuck Dougherty was dialing in and heading towards the front of the field. But Leo Adams would dive down low underneath Wade Gagner, somehow make it by as Cody would make contact with the wall. Off the fourth turn, Rondo down low, Leo Adams on the outside. Lap after lap, the three would battle, but impressively, the win would go to Leo Adams. Final events of 1987 would end with a Sunday afternoon format at the Stafford Motor Speedway. Brian McCarthy would go down low as Cody would go spinning with car number 89. Butler would manage to squeak through and so wouldn't the remainder of the field. Tommy Fern dives down low with car number 92 and he will pick up a spot four wide off the turn. Here comes Norm Plantier. He dials in down low underneath Parento as they come off the turn. Plantier is on the inside, off the turn and down to the line. Pretty much evenly matched when suddenly car number 71, Ted Chalmers, hand grenades and hits the wall in the front straightaway. Chuck Dougherty battles to try to get back in contention for position number two, but Rondo is still in command, and he will pick up yet another victory.
Well, what about those late model streets at Stafford? We told you they put on a great show, and they certainly did. You know, next we're going to take a walk around the room here at Auto Parts Swap and Sell and look at what some of the vendors have to offer. But right now, we'll go to a commercial break. When we come back, we'll show you more of Auto Parts Swap and Sell.
East meets West when Minnesota Duluth challenges the Chiefs at Lowell. Hockey East live Friday at 7 p.m.
Coming at you, the World Series of Asphalt Stock Car Racing. Daytona Speed Week 1988. Newsom Arena Speedway, February 5th through 13th. Nine exciting nights of competition. It's the fastest, most exciting half-mile race facility in the country, offering the best in several different divisions of competition. The real excitement of NASCAR-type modifieds with the top New England drivers, plus mini-modifieds, limited late models, and much, much more. Plus ASA All-Pro drivers, Midwest versus the South, New Smyrna Speedway, February 5th through 13th.
Warm up to baseball, hot stove style, on NESN.
Fly ball, deep left field, way up into the darkness, and this one is out of here. Home run, Jim Rice.
The Blue Jays were in town in August. Our hot stove action Sunday, January 24th, 8 o'clock on NESN.
Matter of fact, I'm such a Bruins fan that during the summer, you know, the off season, me and Ma, we stand in front of the refrigerator, open it up, and put little Bruins figures in the freezer just to practice cheering. Sometimes folks come from next door and we all stand around that freezer cheering right into it. Go, Bruins, go! Except that one summer when Mrs. Hunyadi's canary jingles flew into the freezer and we shut it, didn't even know the poor bird was in there, but what the heck? It's all for a good cause. Go, Bruins!
Why do you invest with Charles Schwab?
My commission savings over several years have been substantial. Very substantial.
Well, I just opened my Schwab account this week, bought 100 shares of stock, and I saved, $49.
I cut my commission costs in half. Period.
Here at Schwab, we drive down your commission costs, and we do it with a level of service that you'll really appreciate.
For your free Schwab booklet, call toll-free 800-338-8000.
Well,
Welcome back to Race Week. You know, when we opened up this program, we told you we were coming from the Eastern States Exposition here for Auto Parts Swap and Sell. Well, a major sponsor and a main ingredient in the success story of this event has been Budweiser, the king of beers. And we're going to be taking a look and talking to some of the vendors. Literally, thousands and thousands of people came out for this event, the largest indoor all-automotive flea market of its type in New England. Let's go and talk to some of the people here for Auto Parts Swap and Sell.
This might not look like a great deal to you, but believe it or not, this is a gathering place for auto enthusiasts. They're looking for parts and accessories that they just can't find at the local auto parts store. There's just about everything imaginable here at Auto Parts Swap and Sell. From manifolds to intakes to enthusiasts who can talk about distributors as well as hard-to-get components that you just can't find anyplace in the marketplace. Whether you're looking for a chrome gas cap, a GT emblem, or actual chrome valve covers, chances are you'll find it at the best prices around at an event very similar to Auto Parts Swap and Sell. There's everything on sale, and everybody's an expert. They've got the latest and the greatest and what does work and what doesn't work. From sheet metal parts for obsolete Chevys that are hard to get a hold of to kind of special and unique items. Like imagine this, you can actually wax your car or truck without a rag. You just apply it with your hand, then you wipe it off with your hand. Now that's something that's kind of different. You won't find that at the corner auto parts store. It's called Ultra Finish, but that's not all. Everywhere you look at Auto Parts Swap and Sell, there was somebody selling something that had to do with the automotive market. Or imagine this, looks like a pile of junk, wrong again. This is an example of how a new paint stripper will work and how easy it is to apply. And crankshafts, pistons, more floor pans, you name it, they had it at Auto Parts Swap itself. And see, this is a used race car driver. He's for sale for $15. Why, just the night before, he spent more than $15 at the Magic Lantern. Everything imaginable was up for sale. Complete motors for $5,000 and some very, very special items that you might like to have for your own home. Harry Ferguson had an impressive display of both clocks and plaques on hand that were up for sale. Next, we'll talk to some of the vendors.
We specialize in restoration parts for 62 through 74 Plymouth and Dodge. Most of the items that we sell are pretty hot selling. People who are restoring these earlier cars are in dire need of certain things, trim parts, lenses, things like that. We specialize in buying up this kind of stuff, so there, anything we have for, say, a 69 Barracuda is a hot item and doesn't last very long.
You're selling all these old parts here. Does this mean that when you sell this stuff, you're going to be replacing it with new?
Well, Bruce, everything here is a few years old. We've got a car we ran for the last 2 years, which is for sale, which I think is sold to Dan Avery. And we have a brand new car sitting there with a couple of brand new motors. So this stuff has really nothing to do with our race program. It's stuff that's been used over the years.
We're here representing R&L Automotive Engines. We're in north of New Hampshire. We do all sorts of custom rebuilding. We offer all our parts at wholesale prices. We've got engines and assemblies ready to go. We've got all the people here and the technical help to back up what we're doing. We can do mail order every day of the week, and we offer all sorts of customized service. We've sold a lot of our everyday stuff, camshafts, pistons. We have a lot of combinations that have worked out really good for the people. Our cylinder heads are probably the best value for their money, and people just come back every year, so we look forward to it.
I found a luggage rack I was looking for a Corvette, and I found here a heater switch I was looking for a Corvette.
And for most individuals, they would find the parts that they were in search of. But still, for others, they'd be still looking for those magical ingredients that they would be proud to bring home.
All good things must come to an end. And as you can see, here at Auto Parts Swap and Sell, it has been a spectacular promotion and a real success. You know, we hope you've enjoyed a look at Auto Parts Swap and Sell, where the auto enthusiasts came out in full force. 25,000 people came out to witness the excitement of this event. In addition to that, we relive the excitement from the Stafford Motor Speedway and a look at the SK Modifieds, plus a look at the late model streets. On the next edition of Race Week, we're going to be going to the NASCAR Winston Modified Tour Banquet. We're going to be showing you the drivers in a different atmosphere than you're used to seeing them at. And that's not all. There's a lot of good racing programs still going on in our marketplace, and we'll be visiting them too. So until then, we say thank you for tuning in to Race Week. and thank you for being a part of this exciting edition. We'll see you again next week for more of the best in New England auto racing.